sir had completed his primary education from the Bishop School, Vincent School, Wadia School. Then he had done his MBBS from the AFMC. Then he had done his cardiology at MD from the BJ Medical. And then he had done almost more than 10 years training in the England in the cardiology. And then he was working as a cardiologist. He's still working as a cardiologist and as a managing director of the Ruby Hall Clinic. सो सर एकेडमिक से ज्यादा मैंने जैसे बोला कि मुझे नॉन एकेडमिक चीजों में जानने में आपके बारे में इंटरेस्ट है. सो सर मेरा एक पहला सवाल यह है कि जब 1959 में जब रूबी हॉल शुरू हुआ या सीनियर ग्रैंड्स ने रूबी हॉल की शुरुआत की स्थापना की, दैट टाइम यू आर द ओनली जस्ट 9 years ओल्ड बॉय. सो सर व्हाट मेमोरीज यू हैव अबाउट दैट पीरियड, आप कुछ बता पाएंगे?
सी आई वाज इन स्कूल दैट टाइम. I was a little boy, 9 years old. My father was working at Jahangir Hospital as the first MD physician who had come. But my father was always wanted to do his own thing. So after working at Jahangir for a few years, he decided that he wanted to start his own hospital. Ruby Hall started as a 2-bed hospital. And my father bought that property for 4 lakhs of rupees, that's all. He had the first X-ray machine, which he bought for, I think it was 20,000 rupees. That machine was in Jahangir. So he took that machine. He bought this little property after taking a bank loan from Bank of Maharashtra, because the chairman was his patient. Started a 2-bed, small little hospital. And Ruby has started from a 2-bed hospital today into a 600-bed hospital. And we've added 2 more hospitals, so taking us to nearly 800 to 900 beds today. So it is very hard work that went into building up this empire. It has taken nearly 60 years, maybe 65 years from 1959 to build up what Ruby Hall today, where we are employing 4,500 people, and we have got about more than 300 doctors, 350 doctors working at Ruby Hall Clinic. Now, my father was a very hardworking individual. When I was young, I hardly used to see him. He used to start work at 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock in the morning and go until sometime 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock. Weekends were not at home. Weekends were either he went to Satara or he went to Karad or he went to Ahmednagar or one of the places like that. And that's how we used to get patients from all over Maharashtra started coming to Ruby Hall. So from something very, very small, the hospital has grown and grown and grown. Now we have got, I think we are possibly one of the best equipped hospitals in India today, and I can easily boast in Maharashtra, we are possibly the best equipped hospital in every field of medicine.
It means you had witnessed the small seed growing from the seed to the big banyan tree with the multiple branches.
Yes, multiple branches. Been a lot. Correct.
Yes. सर मेनी टाइम्स वी सी कि अगर बच्चों के एक या दोनों पेरेंट्स डॉक्टर होते हैं तो उनकी बिजी लाइफ एक्सपीरियंस करते हैं कि पेरेंट्स हमेशा बिजी है, दे आर टू मच इनटू द वर्क, एंड देन काफी बार वो डिसाइड करते हैं कि उनको मेडिकल फील्ड में नहीं जाना है पेरेंट्स की बिजी लाइफ देख के. तो आपने आपके फादर की, सीनियर ग्रैंड सर की बिजी लाइफ देखी है, जैसे 8 o'clock से लेकर 12 o'clock तक, देन स्टिल इवन आफ्टर दैट ऑल्सो वॉट मेड यू टू डिसाइड टू गो फॉर द मेडिकल प्रोफेशन, मतलब डॉक्टर बनने का फिर भी क्यों मन किया आपको?
I think I had no choice at all. My father wanted me to become a doctor. My father wanted me to become a cardiac surgeon. Thank God I didn't become a cardiac surgeon, because nowadays cardiac surgeons are not doing as well as cardiologists. Slowly, slowly we are eating in this. So I am very happy I took the decision of becoming a cardiologist. I initially started when I finished my MD. I thought maybe I'll do nephrology.
Oh.
So when I went to Jeslok, that time Jay Prakash Narayan was on dialysis there and I was the registrar there. So I was dialyzing Jay Prakash Narayan in those days, and the cardiologist nephrologist was Dr. Mani. But then life suddenly, I came back to Pune. I started the first dialysis myself in Pune city. I don't know if you all know that. And that time, there was no dialyzer material. So you had to make the actual material to dialyze people. And it came in a big vat. We had to make the, with a big
tubing,
or we had to make the dialysis fluid and started dialysis. And some people would get rigors. And I know the first patient that was dialyzed in the city of Pune was called Fernandez. His wife was a professor and she was very dedicated because Pune had no dialysis machine. So I brought the dialysis machine with Dr. Elwani from he's still around, for Dr. Elwani, nice friend of mine, very senior nephrologist. So him and I started the first dialysis setup. Then would luck would have it, I had a patient who I met one day, and that person's name was Gonzalez. So Gonzalez, then he was living in England and I was treating his mother. He says, why don't you go to England and do some medicine there? So I said, good idea. So after doing my MD, I worked in Ruby for a year or two, and then I left and stayed at Gonzalez's house in England. Gonzalez turned out to be a very, very close friend of mine, and subsequently he became a fairly rich millionaire over a period of time, but he did look after me in the initial stages. Now, when I went to England, you had to take an examination. It was called the PLAV examination, Professional and Linguistic Examination. Now, the funniest thing is, I was working with guy there who was a senior consultant at Westminster Hospital as a just walking around, unpaid job, because I had not taken the PLAB examination. So his name was Dr. Stola. So Stola said, Parvez, you'll get the PLAB examination and then you join me as a senior house officer. What do you want to do? I said, cardiology. He said, let me see if I can find a space. So what happened is, I took the PLAB examination and unfortunately I passed the medical part first shot, but I failed the English part.
Okay.
Mr. Stola could not believe it. He said, this idiot speaks better English than all of us and that has gone to Scotland and taken the exam there. That's why he failed. Now, as luck would have it or unluck would have it, there was a doctor called Abraham. Abraham was like the Meghdi Yaqub of the UK, one of the topmost surgeons of England. And as my luck would have it, his senior registrar fell ill. And the second registrar also had a problem. So I was working and just hanging around in that hospital. So Professor Lincoln comes to me. I was talking to him quite, we were walking and taking rounds together. And he said, Doc, my two people have fallen sick. Can you wash up with me and do cardiac surgery? I said, I got cardiac surgery to Professor Lincoln in London. I said, yes, but I passed the medical part, but I failed the English part. He said, nonsense. I failed the English part. So Professor Lincoln then phones the president of the General Medical Council in England and said, hello, sir. How are you? I've got this guy called Dr. Grant, who's, you know, he's passed this exam, but he's failed the English part. The young man speaks better English than all of us. Can you get him registered? Then phone call comes back after 1 hour. Will you guarantee that he speaks better English than all of us? And Lincoln said, yes. I got my registration. Only person in the world get registered without speaking the English, passing the English test. So that was a great thing that happened to me. Then I was always very, very lucky. They say the guru is in the 12th house. You know, if you believe horoscope, my guru's always been in the 12th house. So whatever I touched, then what happened after 6 months, in England, every job has to be advertised. That means it goes into the BMJ. Now, as luck would have it, the BMJ went on strike. Now then nobody knew where the jobs were. So I, very smart, I went to the Charing Cross Hospital, the office there. And I said, do you have any jobs available? They said, we are desperate because we can't have no job. Nobody knows where the jobs are going. We have got a vacancy in intensive care unit, ICU. Can you do ICU? I said, sure, but I need a 1-year contract, nothing less. He said, but you have not done any ICU job. I said, no. But he said, we are desperate. We'll take you. Can you sign now? I said, sign. I started working in London Charing Cross ICU, which is the main teaching hospital of London. And ICU is their best job. I did 1 year in the ICU there. When you get a job in London in ICU, that means you are supposed to be the smartest and the brightest in the country. Because that job is very rare to give it to anybody. It is the most, they give it only to the white man. No Indian gets that ICU job, Charing Cross, London Teaching Hospital. Mereko mil gaya. After that, it was sailing everywhere. Every job I applied, hey, London Charing Cross, ICU. The guy must be very clever. He doesn't think I'm not an idiot. Anyway, so from there, I moved on and I got one job after the other. And I did my cardiology from England. And subsequently, I came back. I went with nothing in my pocket. When I went, I could not even afford a newspaper. I was so poor because I was a very hardworking guy, but I had no money. I had come up from scratch. My father had also just started Ruby Hall, so he could not send me money. So I was completely self-made. I went with nothing in my pocket. And in 8 years, I was doing extremely well in the UK. And I came back with £100,000 in my pocket. So hard work, commitment. And that's when I came back to the city of Pune and started my practice as a cardiologist nearly 35 years ago. So it's a learning phase. You have to work very, very hard. And that's the way of success. You also got to be very lucky to get move on in life. And I've been very, very lucky, whatever I've been doing.
In the book, The Secret, likha hai ki, for the, your future or for the bright future, God always sends message or give a hint. I think probably Mr. Gonsalves was a big message for you to go to the England and have big experience in the life, which changed your life kind of. So sir, the way you said ki aap 10 saal England mein training di thi, but in short, you were born in the India. So ek taraf se aap Indian doctor hue. तो आपका इंग्लैंड में स्पेसिफिकली बीइंग इंडियन डॉक्टर करके काम करना, इसमें कुछ अलग आपको एक्सपीरियंस लगा?
सी इन इंग्लैंड यू हैव टू बी बेटर देन द व्हाइट मैन ओवर देयर बिकॉज़ यू आर ऑलवेज अ सेकंड क्लास सिटीजन नो मैटर व्हाट यू ट्राई यू हैव टू बी गुड एट योर वर्क यू हैव टू बी वेरी डेडिकेटेड एंड इफ यू आर डेडिकेटेड गुड एट योर वर्क दे रिस्पेक्ट यू एंड देन यू कैन बी ऑन द same level as them. But it's not my own country, and I'm very happy coming back to my own country, which is India. I was born here, I'm brought up here, and I love the experience of the UK because the experience of UK changes your way of thinking in life. You get a broader view of life. Of course, now things have changed. India has come up to a large extent. But the British training that you get, you cannot get it in India. At least the basic training I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the high-end training. You see, in India now what has happened, hospitals are very competitive with one another. So we are always trying to get better, 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 and the best. In England, it is all national health. So there's no competition, but the basic infrastructure for training a doctor, the basic medicine, what you see now, which is unfortunately dying even in our country. We hardly now examine patients like we used to in the past 30 years ago. The stethoscope is slowly, slowly, slowly going away. Everybody, you got this, do an echo. You got that problem, do a stress test. You got that problem, do an angiogram. You got this problem, do an ultrasound. You got this problem. So we are going more like moving from stethoscope. We are slowly moving into a field where we are more or less, depending on instrumentation to do our clinical judgment. So we are slowly, the clinical science is gradually dying in our country. And that's all over the world. All people have the same problem. like now with this corona coming in, people are hardly touching patients anymore, you know. They're doing the examination behind screens. You got this symptom, you take this treatment, you do this, you do that. And that's what's happening more and more in medicine. So there's a sea change. And because of corona, there is an even mega sea change of what I'm seeing, what we used to do and what is happening today in medicine.
Sir, काफी बार ये कहा जाता है कि because doctors are too busy, so they don't find a time for planning their hospital or planning their business. Or in short, they are not even at a good also for the business planning. But यहाँ पे एक तरफ you are a full time cardiologist, practicing as a full time cardiologist with the Ruby Hall, and on other hand you are also very actively involved in managing the hospital. Not only actively involved, but you play a very critical role in the growing of the Ruby Hall Hospital. From 900 beds, so you are planning कि आप 1800 bed तक आप जाओगे with the current 20 diagnostic centers and nearly Ruby Hall with the branches in all major cities of the Maharashtra. So, फिर एक तरफ ये cardiology की practice और दूसरी तरफ efficiently hospital management. So, how you manage this planning a business also and practicing as a doctor also?
It is called jack of all trades. Jack of all. And you have to be a master of all as well. It's not easy. You see, my life starts at around 9 o'clock. I go to Ruby. I take a round of each and every patient that is under my care. Sometimes I see other patients also, some gynec case, some medical case. I enjoy medicine. So it's a nice case of dengue. I'd like to go and see it. The treatment going on. But he's got cancer. I also go and see it as a cardiologist. Just, hello, how are you? What treatment you are doing? I don't interfere with the treatment, but I just like to know what is basically going on. I sometimes ask the patients, are you happy? What is your problems? Do you have any problems? Well, let's see what we can do. My main, of course, my outpatient goes on from, I finish the round at about 10:30. Then I come back and run my outpatient clinic till about 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. About 4 o'clock, I go into the cath lab and we do about 5-6 procedures, which goes on. I finish work at 6. Then I go to the gym. I go to the gym meticulously for 1 hour every single day, even on a Sunday. And the type of exercises that I used to do and what I've now changed slightly is slightly different. I used to do a treadmill at a speed of 6 for about 30 minutes every day. But then last 6-7 months, I started getting mild knee pain. So I've stopped it. And now I'm doing a stepper. I do the stepper for about 12 minutes. You know, the stepper, you just stepper. After that, I do. So my advice to everybody is, don't do too much treadmill, because over a period of time it can affect your knee, the cartilage. That's the mistake I made. I was doing it for 30 years treadmill, more than that, 35 years. So do the stepper instead. I think it's a little better exercise. Luckily, I don't have any major problem with my knee, but it started to start. So that's the reason I have to shift. Then do abdominals. You must do good abdominals, so you strengthen your abdominal muscle. And do light weights. Don't do anything more than 2.5 kilos, 3 kilos, 4 kilos, maximum 5 kilos, because otherwise it can affect the heart. So these steady exercises you must do. Then I go home. Twice in a week, I go out partying, some party or the other. And I like to have one drink at night. Normally I drink only gin. I don't drink whiskey. I don't do anything else. So one small gin is what I have with a little bit of diet tonic water, no sugar in it. So that's my normal routine. I'm quite happy with following this routine. I have been going to every Thursday. I used to go to peripheral places like my father. I worked extremely hard. I used to go. Sometimes I used to go to Solapur. By Solapur, I used to get up. The train would leave at 11 o'clock Pune. I used to come home at 3:30 in the night, see about 60, 70 patients and take the evening train back from Solapur. So I've done that for 20 years, 25 years. One Thursday, I used to go to Nasik. Then another Thursday, I used to go to Satara and Karad. And then another Thursday was Ahmednagar and Bid. all the way. So it's been a struggle. It's not easy. What I've worked extremely hard for. This traveling, I stopped 2 years ago because I started getting a bit of backache taking on these long trips. But I used to do 1 lakh kilometers every year for the last 30 years.
And that,
very long, very big private practice outside Pune city. 75% of my patients are from outside Pune. They're not from Pune.
So, but sir, do you do, do any extra efforts or ye sab business planning karne ke liye ya? Because expansion is a kind of business, though the medical profession we call it as a noble, but having a hospital set up, growing it is a kind of business only. So, ye karne ke liye aap kuch special efforts karte ho, kisi specific businessman ko follow karte ho?
No. See, Ruby Hall Clinic is a charitable trust. So whatever money Ruby Hall Clinic makes goes back to the trust. Whatever I earn from my private practice comes to me. And that's the way it has always been, and that's the way it will always be. Now, Ruby Hall is doing well. Why is Ruby Hall doing extremely well as compared to the competition? The reason is very simple. Number one, I always get the best equipment. And the best equipment in the world will first come to Ruby Hall. Whether it's an MRI, whether it's a CT scan or a color Doppler or a Holter or whatever, or even a robotic surgery robot. The robot now costs 22 crores, but Ruby Hall has bought it. Today I've got 3 cath labs. I've just bought my 4th cath lab. The 4th cath lab will be a complete biplane neuro cath lab. That will be for only neuro intervention. Get a stroke. We rush you to Ruby, we do neuro intervention, and we immediately open the blocked artery or whatever is required to sort the problem out. I can also tell you very secretly that today we are also going into cancer in a very big way. Okay. We have recently joined with a company called Variant to set up the state-of-the-art cancer unit in Ruby Hall. We already have 3 machines. In fact, we have 4 linear accelerators, and one is going to go and this new one will come in. This one machine will be 65 crores. So you can imagine the investments that we are putting into cancer.
Cancer.
And this machine will be such that it will use artificial intelligence to give radiation. So suppose you have a prostate cancer. What is happening in the older machines, you also radiate the stomach a little bit. You also radiate the bladder. Hmm. If you get the stomach, all get gastritis coming in to these patients who have cancer who have been radiated. Or if you by mistake, you radiate the bladder, you will get frequency of urine, which is something not very good. So this new artificial intelligent machine is going to revolutionize the cancer center. And we will be the first machine in the whole of Asia Pacific, including Japan, to have this machine. And we'll be the first machine center in the private sector to have 4 linear accelerators under one roof. So that's the area of specialization we are going to head very shortly. Of course, cardiac, we are the 3rd largest cardiac center in the country today. We do something like 30 angiographies and some 11 to 12 angioplasties. We've got a fantastic team of cardiologists who work very closely with me. And most of the team has been with us for more than 30 years. In fact, the first live angioplasty workshop in India was held at Ruby Hall Clinic, I can proudly say. I can say one important statement today that the first patient that we did 36 years ago when there was no stent, his name was Shantila Linford. His artery is still open after 36 years of angioplasty without a stent. So I'm very, very proud of our first patient that we did at Ruby Hall Clinic. So yes, Ruby Hall all the time keeps up with technology. We have a very good CEO, my cousin, Mr. Bhatt, and now Manisha Karmarkar is joined us as a joint CEO also of Ruby Hall. So that's the next generation that is, we're trying to build up the next generation. Because after all, we are all getting a little bit old, and you have to now start thinking about the next people coming into and running the institution that we have made. We are shortly also starting a hospital in Amanara city. That will be our fourth hospital. You know, we have Main Ruby Hall, we have Vanavri, we have Hinjabadi, and one hospital is coming on in Satara itself. Nowadays, every 1 month, a builder comes to me. I want to join with you and start a hospital, Dr. Sahab. Aap successful hai, toh humko bhi, hum paisa dalta hai. Aap humko technology do aur humara hospital banao aur chalo. So suddenly everybody wants to become rich and wants to copy the Ruby Hall formula. But it's not easy. Making a hospital is very easy. Running a hospital is very difficult. For those people who are thinking of making hospitals, please remember, it's very difficult to run a hospital, very easy to make it. Bricks and mortar is easy to put up, but running a hospital, see the positions of hotels today. All hotels are practically bankrupt in the city of Pune, Bombay. Most of them are completely lost, losing money. So don't rush into something that you cannot manage later on, because you will not be able to sustain the loans and the loans that you take. I have also started many units outside Pune. I've got 21 units now running, all with MRIs and some with CT scans. I've got units in Satara, Ahmednagar, Karaj, Srirampur. I don't even know where my units are. But all of them are doing well. And what I've done in these units, I've taken the doctors with me. I've made them investors with me. So I think this is a very important thing which started nearly 25 years ago. I started my first CT scan in Satara. And that CT scan was, what I did is I got a few doctors of Satara together. I think that CT scan was about, in those days, it was about 70, 80 lakhs. So I got about 20 lakhs from the investors of Satara. I took a bank loan for the remaining amount and started the CT scan. The CT scan first year did not do well, started making losses. The manager was siphoning off all the money and we were losing money. Then one day I went to Satara and I was giving a guest lecture. After the guest lecture, we went for a drink. And there was this barman that came to me. His name was Mr. Lavan. I don't know whether he's listening to me today or not, but I hope he is. So I said, what are you doing? He said, sir, I've just retired from, I was a commander in the Navy. Now I'm retired. I'm working as a barman in charge of this. I said, why are you wasting your time here? I said, can you manage a small center? If you said, yes, sir. He came and saluted me. I said, you come to Ruby Hall tomorrow. So the next morning he lands up at Ruby Hall. I'd forgotten, I told him. He said, you offered me a job. I said, yes, yes, I was joking. He said, no, 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 I'm ready. So I took him as a manager of that Satara unit and he did an extremely good job. From that CT scan, we went on to MRI. And now he's running about 8 or 9 MRIs and CT scans. Oh. Similarly, one day, I used to have a person called Dasase, who was like my ward boy. You know, I used to go to Nagar also. So I found this guy quite smart. I used to pay him 1200 rupees a month just to be when I was going there. And I found him very smart. I employed him and today he's earning more than 3 lakhs a month.
Oh. Inspiring.
Finding a good people is a skill, sir, actually.
And he's also running some 8 to 12 MRIs. So these two people have been the backbone of my peripheral units. And my strategy was very simple. I borrowed money from these doctors. I went to the bank, put the money, took a loan. The bank used to give me loans. And I used to always repay them. And I used to pay the doctors every month, those who have also invested. The depreciation was mine against my private practice. So I never didn't pay any income tax as well. So I had one of the largest private practice, because in an MRI, remember, you get 40% depreciation. So I was very lucky. I have not invested one rupee. And I'm still earning 22 MRIs, which I built up over 25 years without investing one paisa. Of course, I took the risk of taking the bank loans, which I have started, which I've always paid back on time. And I'm very particular about each and every project that I take up. By 8 o'clock, each MRI manager has to give me the report, how many cases he has done that day. And I analyze it, and I will ring him back if the numbers have gone down. So I'm very particular about everything that I do. And that's one of the reasons that all these units are successful and all these units are doing well. We also try to upgrade all these units from time to time. If there's a 1.5, now in Satara, we put a 3 Tesla. We're looking at other 3 Teslas as you go along. So you have to be focused in what you do in life, and you should know when to invest and where to invest. Sometimes you can also go wrong. Like I put a machine in Parbhani because my partner in Parbhani promised me I will do 18 cases a day. He did not give me 18 cases. We are stuck at 8 to 9 cases, and the only unit we are still losing money is in the Parbhani unit. And that is also, it's only 1 year old. So I think that will also slowly pick up. We can take a loss in one unit and so many running together. So life is not so simple. You have to be focused. You have to be kind. You have to be caring. I do a lot of charity work. That's why God has blessed me. We do about 1 crore free treatment every month at Ruby Hall. We try to help as many people as we can. Anybody with a yellow rash card, poor, needs angioplasty. I try to bring down the cost maximum so that I can help this poor fellow. Every day, we probably do one angioplasty completely free of charge, including the stent. But they have to be poor and really for that, because we don't want anyone to cheat us, you know. These have to be poor people, which we like to help. And because God has given us everything, you have to give back to society something.
Yeah, yes, that's true.
Very important. Absolutely, yes, correct. Sir. That is what.
Sir, managing a hospital is not a, or managing a diagnostic center, whatever it is. But management is not just receiving the calls or just sending them, giving them a call back. It contains the administration, looking after the finances, people working there, and the customers or the patients. And yes, sab kuch ye jo laga dikha 4 points hi hai, but it has a multiple again other points also, and it's not an easy job. So yes, sab manage karte hue, do you also sometimes feel stressful? And if yes, then what is your stress buster?
Actually, I have never had stress as far as management is concerned. I have been very, very lucky. I have my cousin Mr. Bhatt, who's I've given him a free hand, and he's basically done a fantastic job. I have not been bothered about management too much. And as you say, I've been very lucky. Everything falls into place. I know Ruby Hall is blessed. The hospital is blessed. And that's why our results are good in most specialties. Anybody criticizes Ruby Hall is like a bow and arrow. The arrow goes back and hits him in some way or other. I don't know why. So that's why I always say my guru is in the 12th house, and God has given me that guru. So very, very lucky that I don't have to. Things seem to just fall into place as far as I'm concerned. And of course, I go through some areas where some things do go wrong, but in the end, it always works out right. So that is, I don't know. There are some people who just, one of those.
You seem to be a born lucky, sir, I think.
I am.
So for any doctor, whatever the ups and downs are going on, his personal life, professional life, when he is sitting across the table with the patient, he has to be very calm, patience, and fully devoted to the towards the patient. yeah. And फिर पेशेंट से बात करना, कम्युनिकेट करना, फिर वो एक अलग से टैलेंट है या उसकी एक स्पेशल डॉक्टर के लिए वो स्पेशल होना चाहिए कम्युनिकेशन. But communicating with the VIP patient, treating a VIP patient again goes a tricky because we have to maintain that VIP status also. So what is your experience? How do you deal with the VIP patients? Because Ruby Hall being very famous in the Maharashtra, a lot of VIP patients must be coming there.
I think I'm very lucky because the top five richest people in this area are affiliated to Ruby Hall in some way or other. Maybe Ruby Hall is attracting them, or maybe they are giving them very good service or something that attracts them to keep coming to Ruby Hall. And I try to personally look after these people to the best of my ability. I like to spoil them and give them the best treatment that we can give them. If you see the new suites that we have made at Ruby Hall, I can bet you the suites at Ruby Hall are better than the Ritz-Carlton suites. Oh. Yesterday, I was in Delhi. I went to Medanta Hospital, that is supposed to be the best hospital. The suites at Ruby Hall are 10 times better than the suites at Medanta, and they charge 60,000 rupees per night for those suites. Oh. And there is just no comparison between the suites. I'll tell you a true story that happened, and this is a real true story that happened two nights ago. One of my very close friends, very rich man, took his own private jet and went to Delhi. At Delhi, at about 11 o'clock in the night, he calls me and says, "Doc, I've got severe chest pain." I said, "You've got chest, but you're only 50 years old." No, I cannot. I'm very serious. What do I do? So I rang my friend at, where was this? The Escott's Heart Institute, who's the chief cardiologist there. He used my contemporary in UK. We used to share the same room together. He said, "Parvez, I can't help you. I've got corona positive." I said, "But you must be having your registrar." He said, "Yes, I have." So we sent him there. We did his ECG. He sent me the ECG. ECG mein to kuch nahi hai. Then bola, echo kar. Echo kiya. Wo dekha echo. Echo mein bhi kuch nahi hai. I said, "But he's having pain going to the back. At least screen the aorta." We screened the aorta, dissection of the aorta. Shit. Now, I said, "You better operate." He took a CT scan and confirmed. I said, "You have to operate." He said, "Kya ho gaya?" "Arre, but my surgeon has also got corona. So, the surgeon who operates has also got corona. You can't do corona. Can't do this. You need to do a Bental surgery. That means replace the aortic valve and put a conduit right across. A very, very big operation. Important VIP." He said, "Can't operate. Shit." Then I said, I was in my bedroom trying to coordinate what to do now. This VIP is there, he's got severe chest pain, he's got a dissection of the aorta, Scott's Heart Institute, which is 40s, can't operate. Vigya Karnega. So then I picked up the phone and I spoke to my guru in the US, Samir Sharma. He's the head of cardiology in Mount Sinai Hospital, you know, in New York. I said, "Samir, kya karnega yaar? Is ala?" Two choices: bring him back to Pune, operate in Pune. Second, send him to Bombay. Third choice, find somebody in Delhi. So Delhi mein. So I used my brain and I spoke to Samir Sharma, and Samir Sharma said, "Go to this guy at this place, see if he's..." Now that by that time it was 12:30 in the night. So 12:30 baje mein again that doctor ko phone kiya at Medanta Hospital. I said, luckily he picked up the phone. So it's a chain of events. He picked up the phone, 12:30 in the night. He said, "I said, I'm Dr. Grant from Ruby Hall." He said, "I know Ruby Hall. I know Dr. Grant. You are Dr. Grant?" I said, "Yes." I said, "You heard of me?" He said, "Yes. Who hasn't heard of you in cardiology, Baba?" So he said, "But I'm also positive." That means three doctors are positive. One is my friend, who is the chief cardiologist at Escott. His surgeon is positive. This Medanta fellow is also positive. But I said, have you got symptoms? He said, no. His name is Dr. Bhan, by the way, B-A-N-D, Bhan. And he's a vascular surgeon, topmost in the country, and he does only dissections. So I spoke to him, and he said, ek kaam kar Parvez, main kuch karta rehta, tere liye karega kuch cha. So we operated at 8 in the morning. I also went to Delhi, did a damn good job. The guy is saved, and he's fine. I also flew back last night and relieved. So that's the way you have to handle VIP. Now, in this particular case, again, Guru was on my side because everybody picked up the phone in the middle of the night. Everybody was available. And in a dissection, you must operate within 12 hours. Otherwise, you lose the patient. Remember that. So everything happens, you know. So handling VIPs is an art also. Of course, the family is very grateful and that, and the fellow is doing well. I'll not mention any. But this is what happens, and this is the type of service you have to give these people, these VIPs. And I'm happy I could save this guy's life. Had he not phoned me today, he wouldn't be here. I can promise you that, because he was completely dissected right from the top to the bottom. So that's how life goes on. And if you want to ask me any more questions, you're most welcome to ask me.
Yes, sir. We had heard that apart from the practicing as a cardiologist and managing a hospital, you are very much interested and you are very active in a share market. So can you just tell about that?
That's a very interesting story, because one day, this happened many years ago. This goes back about 35 years ago. I had a very rich man. I won't mention his name because it's not correct. But this guy was renting a property from me. And the bugger would not pay the rent. And he's a very big family of Pune. And one day I got very angry with him. And I said, Mr. His name was Rahul, one of the Rahul. I said, you have not paid my rent. Yeah, I'm a very doctor just coming up. It is some 15,000 rupees a month. Wo bhi sala tu paisa nahi de raha hai. It's not fair. Anyway, he came to my office. And that day he told me, he said, okay, Parvez, I'll pay your rent. Don't worry. But I'll also give you a tip. I said, what is the tip? He said, you buy my shares. I said, why should I buy your bloody shares, yaar? I'm not a bloody share broker. He said, tu dekh. He said, it's only 3 rupees, yaar. Put in some money. So I bought some shares from him. And within 6 months, that share became 45 rupees. I said, Salai, why am I doing practicing medicine? Why don't I do share instead of this stupid I sit and see a patient and I used to earn 100 rupees, 200 rupees from that patient. And so I started this thing in a very small way. I mean, then now I do it more as a hobby rather than as a way of making money. It's, for me, it's just fun. I enjoy it. It makes me read about companies. It makes me read about business. It tells me how things are moving in the financial start of work, which helps me also in developing Ruby Hall to some extent. But I'll tell you another funny story that happened only 6 weeks ago. My son, name is Simon, he has a friend. So one day he comes to me and he said, Dari, there's a company called XYZ. You buy the shares. I said, how much are the shares? He said, 6 rupees. I said, 6 rupees. Okay, I went mad that day. I bought 4 lakh shares. And within 6 weeks, that has become 26 rupees. So I made 65 lakhs in 6 weeks. I said, what the hell am I doing practicing medicine, yaar? But this is a one-off thing. Don't think everybody will do that and everybody will be so lucky, because you must realize that what goes up also comes down. In America, there was a surgeon called Denton Cooley. Denton Cooley was the greatest cardiac surgeon the world has ever produced. He started Houston Heart Hospital. Denton Cooley used to do 26 bypasses a day, and people from all over the world used to go to Denton Cooley for their cardiac surgery. Denton Cooley became very rich. He had his own private jet also. Unfortunately, he started investing in the stock market, and by the time he died bankrupt without one paisa in his pocket. So don't get carried away. Do not invest nothing more than 5% of your money on the stock market ever, because it's a very dangerous thing. It's a gamble. You can be very lucky, and I'm lucky, so I'm doing well. But everybody may not be so lucky. So don't get involved in all these sort of things. As I said, not even more than 5%. See, what happens today, if you invest in a bank, you get about 6 to 7% interest. Now, the government is too smart. They take 35% tax they make you on that. So you land up with 2.5% in your pocket. On the other hand, you invest in a company like Infosys or Tata Motors or something, you will get a steady 20-25% return on your money. So if you're investing, always invest in big companies like Infosys or TCS, or you can invest in big companies or any of these big companies, you'll find your money is safe. So always don't go for these small, tiny, mini companies, because most of the promoters are cheats and they'll take you for a ride. So concentrate on big companies. You will get a good return of 20-25% very easily. Or put your money in mutual funds where you are quite...
8%. So it is basically inversely proportional relationship. The larger the company, large cap, the growth may be the slow, but you are secure. And the small cap, the growth may be faster, but you are really at risk, always at risk.
Can be very insecure.
Yes, yes. Sir, one thing, the senior Dr. Grant, sir, your father, Dr. K.P. Grant, everybody knows ki apart from being a very great doctor, dedicated and hard doctor, he was also a very great human being. So we know all about him as a doctor only, but how was he as a family man? How was your son-father relationship?
No, my father and I were always got on very well. He was a very kind and caring person. My father was never money-minded. He didn't care a damn about money. But I spent very little time with him. I hardly ever went on holiday with him, because he was just dedicated to his work and his hospital. Life was the hospital. So family life was very less, especially in the beginning period. Later on, as he grew older, he got closer and closer to me. But family life was, I was more with my mother than with my father. And I also, you know, I was also doing medicine. So I was also studying most of the time. And it was not easy, getting into medicine, especially competing in Armed Forces Medical College. Then in BJ, again, there's severe competition because the cleverest people were there. And you have to compete with all these clever fellows. But one thing I can tell you that it is not necessary that you come first in class and second in class and third in class. Because what I have found is you have to be street smart more than class smart. In life, be street smart. See my friend, take Dr. Cyrus Poonawalla. He just finished his SSC and today he's one of the richest men, Serum Institute, built it up. He's street smart. And that is what, and you will find that most of these people who are very clever do not necessarily do very well in life. And those who are middle of the range, like myself, who are probably little, I'm not saying I'm street smart, but who are little street smart are doing extremely well in life. So in life, you have to be overall, not just bookworm. You see, my idea is that don't become a bookworm. It's not necessary to come first. What the hell are we doing coming first? Yes, academically, very great, very, very good. But you have to have overall personality in life if you want to do well in life. You have to have a broad view of life. And this is what I learned going from England. Had I not gone to England, I would have still been that little narrow-minded Puneite, as they say. Because now things have changed. Pune has opened up. But in my time, I used to go to school on a bicycle. And I was in college, I used to have a little a green colored Bajaj auto, which also came out of turn because my father knew Rahul Bajaj as a Bajaj auto. So waiting list used to be 12 years to get a motorcycle in those, get a scooter in those days. So things were quite different those days as compared to what things are today. Today, I think things have really changed. The country has started coming up. Future looks very bright for India. And I wish I was younger.
That's why it is said that great and life-changing lessons are always learnt in the society, not in the classrooms.
Correct.
Yes, sir. Yes. So now, last and important thing, now you need to do a favor for me. Even I want to plan some starting new venture, starting something big like you. So you need to share some secrets and tip for me so I can even grow professionally and have something bigger like you.
See, always start small and always go in a small way. Don't take too many partners in any venture that you go into. Be very care of who you take. And because, you know, after all, it's a long-term strategy. And if your partner cheats you in some way, then you should just withdraw and say, thank you very much and move on. I set up quite a few units in Uganda, but I found that my partner was not so straight. I said, thank you very much. Good luck. Goodbye. And he walked off. I've also set up, we were to set up a unit in Bahrain. And I did invest money in Bahrain. I was very lucky there. I put in, I'll be very honest with you, the Bahrain was a big project. Unfortunately, my partner turned out to be a big crook. But again, my guru was with me. And I'll be very honest with you. I put in 1 crore of rupees, which I borrowed from my father. And he also invested. The Chabria group put in 1 crore. But the Bahraini people, we were only 10% partners and the remaining 45% money came from Bahrain. But the Indian CEO turned out to be a big crook and he siphoned off all the money. But luckily for me, the Bahraini chairman of the hospital, he passed a board resolution closing the hospital down without taking the board members to, he sold the hospital to an Irani specialist hospital, the Bahraini hospital, without taking a board resolution. So I filed a case against him in the Bahraini court. Lower court I won, high court I won. It went to the Supreme Court of Bahrain. From Supreme Court of Bahrain, being a Bahraini, they sent it back to the high court. And finally, I went back from the High Court to the Supreme Court. And I won in the Supreme Court of Bahrain against the Bahraini national. Oh. And I got, it went on for 11 years. And that 2 crores that we invested, we got the full money back. But then the Indian rupee fell by 60%. So we got 3.5 crores back. And I gave each and every one, though the check came in my name, all those who invested, including, there was a pathology lab, poor fellow died recently. That money also I gave them all back. Whoever invested got all the money back from the Bahraini group. So, yes, hello, can you hear?
No, yeah. Yes, sir, we can hear. Please.
So, you see, sometimes you take risks and sometimes you can go very much wrong in taking risks. I took a risk in Bahrain. I could have lost everything. But I was just lucky. I persisted. I know I paid the lawyers fees of nearly 30 lakhs. Only lawyers fees to fight the case in Bahrain. But I did persist. So in life, you have to be very persistent. Don't give up. Okay, we have been cheated, but that is my money. It's hard-earned money. You have to get it back at any cost. And I returned every single pie to everybody who invested in Bahrain, which is something no other person would have done. I could have just taken away the full amount and said, thank you very much. Because it happened over 11 years. But that's honesty and caringness and kindness, which you have to learn in life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So hope, sir, you remember our name, and so we can knock your door anytime where if we stuck anywhere.
I anybody in my office anytime. Don't have appointment system. I have nothing, and that's the reason I'm very happy. Nobody takes an appointment to meet me. They can
No, that's why.
From 10 to 5, you're most welcome. If I can help you, I will help you.
That's why I think, besides the managing director of Rubiol Clinic, besides cardiologist, Dr. Parvez is a fantastic human being. Whenever you call him, he always picked up your phone, whether he's in UK or whether he's in Dubai or anywhere. That is something I really appreciate, or everyone appreciates.
Yeah, because communication is very important in medicine. Can you imagine?
I had not. Yeah, this is PI is very important, and that's why I think the most famous and prominent consultants are with Ruby Hall Clinic because of your nature.
Well, that's life. Life moves on. We have to all move on. But yeah, you must answer the phone. I get very irritated if somebody doesn't answer the phone.
No, that is really a fantastic, experience.
No, at that night, two nights ago, if I had not answered at 11 o'clock, this man who is very, very famous, I'll not mention any names, but he would have died. Honestly, I'm telling you, he would have not survived. But he's very, very lucky. And I'm very happy to help him. That's all. It's not good to mention names.
Yes, it was really great to listen about the different aspects, different phases of your life, and very interesting stories about your decision for going to in the England, starting a CT scan unit, investing in starting a business in the Sangli. So it was really helpful for every doctor. And बस हम लोग यही चाहते हैं कि यही experience से हर एक को सीखने को मिले. और जहां पे भी डिफिकल्ट आए, एक्सपीरियंस को हम लोग एक लेसन के तरह याद करके अपने मुश्किलों का सामना कर पाए. सो वंस अगेन वेरी थैंक यू फॉर बीइंग हियर, एंड आई आल्सो थैंक यू लोकमत फॉर मेकिंग दिस लाइव इवेंट. थैंक यू वंस अगेन सर. गुड नाइट.
प्लेजर. थैंक यू वेरी मच.